Hi, welcome everyone to Broken and Beautiful. My name is Ediambolo Fungula, and this is my lovely host, Roberta Gonzales.
Thank you for having me today, Edia. It's such a pleasure. You know, I always love hooking up with you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Roberta, for coming here. And I know you guys are probably out there wondering, Broken and Beautiful. And, you know, some of you guys, I already told you guys that I'm getting ready to start having this show with Roberta. And a lot of you guys been asking me, so, Edie, what is this show? I mean, what's the meaning? What's the thesis, the theme of this show, Broken and Beautiful? And why? Broken and Beautiful. Couldn't you come up with another title? Why? Because whenever you think about broken, it doesn't sound too good, right?
It doesn't sound sexy. It doesn't sound positive, right?
Right.
But we're going to try to tell people how they could be broken and turn it into a positive thing.
Yes. Yes. You heard it from Roberta. That's exactly what it is. I know a lot of time people, you know, being the owner of Main Street Hair, being coming here from Congo, Africa, being an African woman, of course, I usually walk around downtown. You might see me with my, you know, hair done, extension, yes, walking pride, because culturally I was taught that regardless of what's going on, you get yourself together and you carry yourself with pride, right? Regardless of what's going on in your life.
It's amazing. You have to have that presence still. But how do you find that presence when you're hurting inside so much?
Yeah.
And how did you ever find that? Tell me about you.
You know, and this is why, honestly, I thought that this show is so well needed, because a lot of us, so even myself, I am that kind of individual where a lot of time I find myself, I have a lot of things that I'm dealing with,
mm-hmm,
but at the end of the day, like even today, I have to come, put my makeup on, and come here and come do this show, or,
yeah,
you know, having a degree in theater, a lot of time you have to kind of put on faces, put on a mask.
Well, I think it's harder than ever before because of social media, because of Facebook, because of Instagram, because of Twitter, because of Snapchat or whatever. People, it seems like everybody's happy all the time and have the most beautiful life all the time, and you have everything that you want all the time. You don't ever post your struggles.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, you post yourself being happy with that loved one, or on a vacation, or you think your body's looking good or whatever, but we don't post the real us all of the time.
Yes.
We just don't.
Yes.
And so it's a false image, and we all have some trials and tribulations, and some of us have more than others.
Yeah. And this is the reason. This is the reason why I thought, because back in the days, I used to think that I was the only one. I was the only one having all these struggles and all these obstacles. And, you know, coming from Africa, I thought, well, you know, when I moved to America, the land of freedom, the land of milk and honey, everything is gonna be great for me. And Roberta, you know, I kind of felt like, in a lot of way, like I flee from a lion to come in contact with a bear, you know, my struggles in America. And then I come here, and then I notice a lot of people, a lot of my people, like black people, had a lot of struggles. So then I thought that it was just a black struggle. But then the more I lived here, the more I traveled, the more I engaged with so many different people, I realized that it's a human, we're part of the human race, and we are like glass. And at any given moment, we can all break. And at any given moment, if something can happen to us, we can bleed, life sometimes don't even give us a warning. Mm-hmm. This is why something in my spirit was telling me, because I usually would convey my message through more like theatrical way, through shows. But something was telling me in my spirit that I did need to give birth to this show where I can invite more people, more real people, even women like yourself, Roberta. I follow you. You're like one of the people, one of the individuals, women that I respect, like Oprah, like in our community here in Pleasanton, because I watch you on TV, but then again, I read about your struggles, how you lost so many members of your family, but then a lot of time, I see you downtown, you still have a smile on your face. I hear about a lot of things that you're doing for the community. So I wanna be able to talk about things like that, you know?
Yeah, and why do you think people are so reluctant to talk about their struggles? Are they just trying to keep things close to the vest and don't want to be so open and honest? Or do you just, you know, I don't know. I find it very difficult to talk to people and have them be honest about what's going on in their life.
Yeah. You know, I'm not a therapist, Roberta, or anything like that. But I think a lot of it, for me, I can only speak from my own perspective. You know, coming from a culture like Africa, as I indicated earlier, you can't really, it's kind of like a sign of weakness.
Oh, that's a good point. Yeah.
To show your weakness.
So I'm an open book. You know, what you see and what you read is what you get, pretty much. I don't have any false pretenses at all. When my most traumatic, there's been a couple of really traumatic years of my life, but the most traumatic I would say was 2013, when at the same time I was going through a divorce, I changed my work schedule, I lost my dog that I had for 17 years, then a month later my mom died, 4 months later my brother died, and so then I had to sell my house because I was getting divorced, and my priest told me most people only go through one of those things in a lifetime, and I went through six of those things all within a short amount of time. And no, I didn't advertise it, you know, to the public at that time, because I was working through it and I was guarding my kids.
Yeah.
Because I have two sons, I wasn't out there telling everyone, hey, I'm going through a divorce, anything like that. I was working through it.
Yeah.
I wasn't trying to deny it.
Yeah.
I was trying to work through it myself. But then when I came out on the other side, was I able to talk about it? But for me, when you go through a divorce, it's a death.
Yeah.
It's a death. But the only thing is, they're not dead. They're still walking around and dating and do whatever they want to do. So it's really hard.
Yeah.
It's really hard, but it's a death. And it was very devastating, because when I married, and I married in the Catholic Church, that was for life.
Yeah.
I married for life. Till death do we part. So I had to go through my priest to help me through it.
Yeah.
And then at the same time while I'm going through that, my mom dies, my brother dies, my dog dies, my job changed, you know, because at least you go to work and you have your routine.
Yeah.
You know, I had to change my hours completely in my days. I went from like Monday through Fridays to Wednesday through Sundays, and instead of working in the mornings or at night, I was working this complete, it was a complete turnaround.
Yeah.
And when your job is turned around and your life is turned around at the same time, what do you have to hold you steady? What is your safety net? What is your safety net? How am I going to take care of my two boys while I'm going through all this turmoil? My life is upside down. Well, for me, it was, okay, you go to therapy or you go to church or you do both.
Yeah.
And I did consult somebody who's a wonderful person, but the bottom line was I had to have my faith.
Yes.
I had to have my faith. And people ask me all the time, oh, you seem like a really religious person. I don't think I'm really religious.
Yeah.
I think I'm extremely faithful.
Yeah.
And I'm extremely spiritual.
Yes.
And that's what helps guide me. And yes, you know, I do read the Bible every single day. I do do that. But I still, I question things. Mm-hmm. And I think that's only normal, right? Mm-hmm, in your life, I'm sure you question things all the time.
Oh my gosh. I have a question for you. When you were going through all of that, did you feel a little like maybe God was, it's like it was your fault, like,
yes,
God, are you punishing me?
Yes.
Because you're human, right? Even though you are a spiritual individual, I'm pretty sure there were times where you kind of was questioning God and also asking the why question. I know we're not supposed to ask that.
No, there's two times in my life, and you and I discussed this before. My younger brother was 15 years old, and he was shot and killed on my 21st birthday.
Oh,
so your 21st birthday is a mark in your life,
yes,
you know?
Yes.
And when my brother died on that day, very violently,
wow,
I questioned God, like, what are you doing to me? What message are you sending me?
Yeah.
And at that time, I should have gone to counseling, but I was a college student and couldn't afford it. And my parents were struggling. I had to quit college and go home and take care of them, that I didn't have time to take care of myself,
yeah,
and figure these things out at all.
Wow.
So I started running. And by running, that helped me see the blue sky again, hear the birds sing,
yeah,
see the green trees, see a white butterfly, because everything was so dark before. Everything was dark, but then I started opening my eyes and trying to look at the signs and listen to the signs. And I had to work my way through it. And it wasn't until later in life that I was able to afford some counseling that did help me. Because we don't have, I think people forget. You think like going to a counselor is a weakness. It's not. We don't have all the answers.
No,
I don't have all the answers.
Yeah.
And I talk to God all the time, and I did that saying, what are you doing to me? Is this,
yeah,
are you punishing me? You took my brother on my birthday,
yeah,
really? But then I ran a marathon because I started running because my brother died.
Yeah.
I started running. And all of a sudden, I'm doing marathons, which I never dreamed I'd do. And I'm standing in the Roman Colosseum going to run the Roman marathon.
Yeah.
And there were 10,000 people, and 90% of it was all men. And I looked up in the sky and I said, God, whatever made me dream so big that I'd be running a marathon in Rome?
Wow.
That you run past the Spanish Steps, that you run by the Tiber River, that you run into the Colosseum, and I actually could hear like the lions roar and the, you know, the gladiators fighting and stuff. And it was like, I felt all of a sudden that I came full circle, that my brother gave his life for me to live. My brother gave his life for me to live. I've traveled the world since my brother's died, running marathons and doing triathlons and Ironman. I've gone to Switzerland and Japan. I've gone to Austria. I've gone to, you know, Rome. I've gone to London. I've gone to Paris. I've done all these, Chicago, New York, Boston, marathon. Through his death, I have lived. I have lived through his death. And I kind of feel like God gave him to me for me to live. But it was an awful thing to lose them. So how do you balance that, you know?
Yeah.
But I really feel like that happened. God gave me my brother for me to live.
Oh, my
God. Right?
That's incredible.
Isn't that?
That's
just, and it's hard to reckon with, because why? He was only 15. He had his whole life to live.
Yeah. But, and this is why I was telling you. I mean, if someone did not know this about you, Roberta, they would have never known that you had this much loss, because you continue helping, you continue serving, you continue keeping a smile on your face, you continue being a mom, being a businesswoman.
Thank you.
That's what's so incredible. This is why we need this show.
But this is why you and I connected too. We felt this presence within each other.
That warrior presence, that warrior connection, right?
When I first met you, all of a sudden I thought, this woman's a warrior and we have a lot in common, and I like her. And we know, as women, as we have more experiences,
we
lose some people in our lives because we choose to, as far as relationships.
Yes.
Because we only want to surround ourselves with people that make us more energized.
Yes.
And positive.
Yes.
Especially being positive.
Yes.
And honest.
Yes.
And when I met you, I thought, I love this woman. She makes me happy.
The same way. I felt the same way. And even with this show, one day I was sleeping and I said, I have to have this power woman, this, this, and it's not because, it's not even because you were a news lady of the Bay Area. Of course, that's one factor, but more than anything is your testimony. I truly believe that your testimony, a lot of you out there, I know sometimes you wonder, like, why is all this, is this kind of things is only happening to me? And and being a Christian myself too, being a woman of faith, I know that sometimes the enemy, Satan, he likes to make us feel like this kind of situation can only happen to you. Not like someone like Roberta. How could she possibly relate? Look at her. She's been on TV. She's beautiful. She all these great things happening to her. And that's what happened to a lot of people. They come to me like, Edie, what do you know? How could you possibly relate to me?
Well, because you can, especially when we first wanted to start this podcast, we had to delay because your husband was diagnosed with cancer.
Yeah.
And I hope you don't mind talking about that, because again, it shows
you the
obstacles. Oh, this is
broken and beautiful.
It's broken and beautiful. It's the obstacles that come in, and how are we going to get around this challenge? And your husband told you, you go on with this show.
Yeah.
You do this. Yeah. But meanwhile, behind the scenes, your heart is broken.
Yeah. Right now, my heart is broken. My husband is at home. Like I told you earlier, he's been diagnosed with cancer. And my husband and I, our relationship too, have been one of those broken and beautiful relationships. You know, we both come from Congo. We both was raised from dysfunctional, you know, families, you know, so.
And society, a dysfunctional society.
Dysfunctional society. Yeah. Imagine coming from Congo to America. In his situation, he came from Congo to Oakland, California. In my situation, coming from Congo, and 3 years later, my father, my engineer father, passing, you know, so having to navigate through life.
Then coming to Pleasanton, California, where everybody is blonde and beautiful or rich or famous or, you know, I mean, it's a very, you know, prestigious community. And I'm not saying that to be demeaning to anybody at all, but it's a very nice life. It's not. And not to degrade Oakland or anything like that, but it's very Republican. We know this.
Yeah,
it's the kids are schooled, and you have a choice to go to public school or private school. And I mean, one day I was working out in my front yard and I was gardening. Somebody drove by here in Pleasanton. I've been here 25 years, okay, so I can talk about this. But somebody drove by and asked me, how much do I charge? And I said, for what? And they go, to garden. They wanted me to cut their lawn. They weren't used to seeing Mexicans walking around 25 years ago and owning their own home in Pleasanton. We usually work in the restaurants as the cooks, as the chefs, you know, cleaning at the busboys. Yeah. So it was different. And so if it was different for me 25 years ago, I can imagine how it is different from a person from Congo walking the streets of Pleasanton. Yes. And again, nothing against Pleasanton. I love Pleasanton. I would give my blood for Pleasanton. I love it. It's my home. You know, my kids have been here since they were 2 and 3 years old, both of them. And we're very fortunate to live here. But, you know, it was difficult for me when I first got here. I can imagine for you.
It hasn't been easy. It definitely have not been easy, but like I said earlier, I think I was sharing with you how when we first moved here, I would go to like Safeway or something, and I just kept feeling the need to apologize. Like I would come next to people like, I am so sorry. Like I felt like I didn't belong. I didn't belong here. Even having a business here, it took me a while to feel like, hey, you know, I do belong. It took self-discovery, Roberta. I had to go in and realize that I bring something special to the table with my business. I bring something a little bit unique to Pleasanton. Pleasanton is in a need of Main Street
diversity,
hair.
Yeah, hair.
Pleasanton and the world. Yeah. It's in a need of a podcast like this, broken and beautiful. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter what color we are, mm-hmm. how much money we have in our bank account, what education we possess. Like I said earlier, at the end of the day, we all part of the human race. Just like when I take my husband to the doctor for his treatment with cancer, honey, I see all kind of people there getting mm-hmm. treatment, fighting for their lives. They're all different colors. They're men, they're women, different ages. And at that moment, it really puts things into perspective.
Mm-hmm. It does.
The fact that none of that matters. And the people are even a lot nicer when I take them there. Because at that moment when you're fighting for your life, you realize that at the end of the day, we're part of this great planet together. And we need each other. We need to share with each other. This time I might be going through my battles right now. I need a hug. I need a little bit more encouragement. Tomorrow might be yours. Mm-hmm. The next day might be another person. We all, at the end of the day, very, very fragile. And we need to stop acting like
we're invincible.
Yeah.
That, like, bulletproof or something.
Yeah.
You know, we've talked about this also. I've run 32 marathons and 5 full Ironman. And one thing I learned about Ironman is, and it's the same thing with marathons too, you show up to the starting line. Mm-hmm. Doesn't matter if you're black, white, brown, Asian. It doesn't matter anything. Doesn't matter if you have a degree, a PhD. It doesn't matter if you dropped out of school or what. You either finish and cross that finish line or you don't.
Yeah.
You don't. We're all equal. We're all on the same playing field on race day.
Yeah.
On race day, we are. And when you finish, the thing I've learned about those competitions, the only reason why I bring it up, those competitions have taught me how to navigate myself through life. How to, because when, like Ironman, for example, I tell people 90% of it is mental.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you're physically fit and you don't have any injuries, 90% of it's mind over matter. Like, okay, I get all this, how am I going to navigate my way now around a 112-mile bike right now? I get off the bike and how am I going to do a full marathon after I've already swam 2.4 miles and I've already rode, you know, 112 miles on my bike? How am I going to get around this? Because you stumble across people on the course that are in much better shape, physical shape than you, and they're curled up into a heap of nothing crying for their mom. They're crying for their mommy, and it's like, because of this.
Yeah.
It's because of this. You have to be strong and have faith.
Yes.
You have to have faith and be strong and persevere and say, how am I going to get around this obstacle now? And how am I going to get around that obstacle? But when you allow yourself to be weak is when you do not finish.
You're right. And you're right. And then that kind of leads
me
back.
You have to be strong.
To your question earlier about my husband, how am I dealing with this?
Yes.
With this elephant in the room, with this demon, this monster called cancer. That's exactly how I'm approaching it. That's my approach toward it, Roberta. And I also share with you that story that's been helping me. You know, the life of a soldier, the life of a warrior. I'm sorry, but I'm going to say like this because it ain't easy. And what I mean by that is my husband and I read this story the other day about this soldier this is a true story, who fought so many battles and won so many battles. And he was a pilot and he got on the plane flying home. He made it. He didn't die. And then as he was flying, he noticed some noise, and it was this mouse. He turned around, it was this mouse. And this mouse was in this place in the plane where it could have made the plane crashed.
Mm-hmm.
And he thought to myself, like, really, God? I fought all these great battles and I won and I'm going home only to be defeated by a mouse? So you know what he said to himself? He said, you know what? I know what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna increase the latitude. I'm gonna fly higher because my lungs are tougher than this mouse. I'm gonna try that. So indeed, he did that. And you know what? Shortly, the mouse died. It fell and died, and he made it. So I tell you this to tell you, my approach to my situation with my husband right now, I'm not gonna lie, because this is a broken and beautiful show. We're gonna be coming here, and we're gonna come real. And we're gonna be vulnerable, because vulnerability brings about closeness. This is the way that we're gonna even get more closer to you guys as the audience. And we want you guys to even get closer to us. So the way I'm approaching this, Roberta, the way I'm approaching this, you guys who are wandering out there, is that I decided, like this pilot, this warrior, or like Roberta's story, my inspiration, or my warrior iron woman, is just to increase the latitude. Even just doing this show, it's my way of fighting. When I come here, this is my way of fighting this cancer, this demon, and telling it that, look, I fought my way from Congo, Africa to America to be the owner, for us to be the owner in downtown Pleasanton. That's a big deal to just right now be defeated by this cancer.
I love you so much. That's wonderful. That's beautiful. It really is. It will encourage a lot of people. And what you just said, I mean, it encourages me. And I think it's a warrior. It's the warrior in us. Yeah. It's like, through all this devastation and sadness and grief, we stand and we figure it out along the way. Yeah. It's difficult. It's very difficult. And sometimes it could be very, very lonely too. Yeah. But we've got each other. Yes. We've got the group out there watching us.
Yes.
And so, Tom, again, the name of your show, where your business is, because she's got two businesses in Pleasanton, and then they can join us again in about 2 more weeks, right?
Yes, you guys, this is something that Roberta and I, we're going to be doing, and we're going to also be inviting more special guests to join us with different topics. So even if you guys are interested on special topics that you guys want us to talk about, we are open. This is like a family affair.
I like that. It's a family affair. It really is.
So coming from the Bay Area, Pleasanton, downtown Pleasanton, California, downtown in Roberta Gonzales studio with our new beautiful show called
Broken and Beautiful. We'll see you in a couple weeks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you, love. Thank you.